everybody. Good morning.
Good morning.
All right. Heard a couple of you. Stand up. Let's worship the Lord this morning. God's word says to be exalted, O Lord, above the heavens. So, Lord, would you send your glory? The heaven is in the weight of your presence in this room. We worship you, Lord. We honor you, God.
Those of you who are joining us online, it's so good to worship with you today, and thank you for joining us. And it's just such a blessing to be here together and in person or online with the body of believers, to be encouraged by one another, hearing each other lift up the Lord and lift up our praise to the Lord, because we're all walking through something, and we're all going through different seasons of life, but we can all come together and use this moment to give glory to God, because he's worthy of it, no matter what we're walking through. And that's so cool that we get to share that together and that we get to do that together. And so I'm thankful, and I hope you are too. And we're about to sing this next song, and it says, my chains are gone, My debt is paid. The cross is overthrown the grave. Jesus' blood sets us free, and that means death to death and life for me. And I'm so thankful for those lyrics and that we get to declare that truth. And God is so good for giving us that. And I'm thankful for the blood, and I'm thankful for His goodness. And so let's sing this song together and let's worship Him together because He's worthy of it. Amen.
Glory in creation.
Amen.
Now in
everything we walk through, every season of life we walk through, everything that's pushing against us, Lord, you conquer, you win, you are victorious. And Jesus, thank you for letting us share in that victory. Lord, your name is beautiful and it's precious and it is powerful. And Lord, we believe that anything we're going through, Lord, that we can call on your name and you're going to be there. Thank you for your faithfulness. Jesus, you're good and we love you and we praise you and we thank you. And we pray these things in your precious and wonderful and beautiful and powerful name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
North Park family, I'm so glad we get to be here today to worship the Lord Jesus. It's good to see you, whether you're here in person or with us online. I'm glad we get together to worship the risen Lord Jesus. Hey, this week is going to be fantastic. We've got a great week coming up because this begins the week of prayer as we spiritually prepare for next Sunday, for next weekend, for Easter. In the lobby, there's a prayer guide. It's also online. It looks like this. I hope you pick it up. If you didn't pick it up on the way in, I hope you pick it up on the way out. Each day this week, by 6 a.m. every morning, you'll receive an email from our church, from me. You'll get an email with a link in it to click on to watch a very short devotional video to kick off your time of prayer. We'll have an online prayer gathering every we want you to meet with the Lord, and so we're going to do that every day this week. So every day, check your email. You can also get it on the North Park webpage, but check your email. You'll get a link to click, and one of your pastors will lead a devotional about the week of prayer, about the week, Jesus' last week as he was headed toward the cross. And then after you watch the devotional, you've got the prayer guide, and we want you to engage with the Lord Jesus. This is going to be a special week where we as a church call out to the Lord. We as a church pray and we ask the Lord God to do a great thing in us and a great thing among us. So it's going to be a special week, and that's every day, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. On Friday, we have a really special gathering, Friday night. Friday is Good Friday, so Friday night we will gather here for communion, for receiving the Lord's Supper, and a special time of worship and prayer. That's Friday night at 6 o'clock. So as you know that, this is going to be a fantastic week. And then we get to the weekend, next weekend's Easter weekend. Now watch this. We have added an additional worship service next weekend, and it's a Saturday night worship service. Now, Saturday night, it'll be the same worship service as Sunday morning, but this way, we can invite everyone. You can invite your friends, families, neighbors, and even with that, we'll be able to physically distance from each other so that we can worship in safety here. So that's next Saturday. A worship service at 5 p.m. and then three worship services Sunday morning. So super exciting things coming. And then in addition to that, students, you guys know what Saturday morning is. That's our annual Easter egg hunt for the little kids. You guys remember that from when you were little tot? That's it. So that's all of the fun of this coming. I can't wait for all that, just the fun of engaging with the Lord in these times of prayer. I can't wait for Easter Sunday morning. It's going to be fantastic. Well, hey, one other word before we pray. I want to say a word of thank you. If you look at the back of the bulletin, you'll notice that, again, last week, this will make 5 weeks straight that our giving has exceeded our budget goal. That's just such a blessing. Thank you for your faithfulness in giving to the Lord. It's because of our giving together that we as a church were able to do great things again in the kingdom. Hey, thank you for your giving. That's fantastic. As you know, you can give online. You can give by texting the word North Park to the number 77977, or you can also give in the boxes as you exit. Hey, let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the incredible good things that we see happening in our church family. Lord, I'm thankful. I'm excited about this week, God, as we have some focused times of fervent prayer. Lord, I pray that you will work in each of our hearts. Lord, that you will draw us to you in a special way. Lord, and as we get ready, as we prepare our hearts for Easter, Lord, I pray that you would just let this be a moment where you work in us. And God, use us to bring others to hear of your gospel next Sunday, next Saturday and next Sunday. Jesus, we thank you for that. Lord, we thank you for allowing us to be partners together in giving to you for the sake of the kingdom. Lord, we pray that you would bless the offerings that we give for your kingdom. We pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen.
To see you this morning on Palm Sunday, the week before Easter. Also welcome all of you who are watching online today. Boy, so proud of our 8 o'clock service this morning. They came to church in a monsoon. I mean, it was coming down and a tremendous storm this morning. Had a decent crowd this morning. I know we still have many that are away for spring break. I hope you guys are watching online. I hope all of you have had a good spring break week. Rondi and I got to go up to Kentucky and got to go to the Creation Museum and the Ark Experience, and it was pretty awesome. How many of you have done that, by the way? Have already been there, Creation Museum, Ark Experience? Several of you. It's pretty amazing. The Ark is really, really big. It really is. And I love the fact. I love that. And not only is it very professionally done, but the whole thing points to the gospel. It points to Jesus Christ. And they are unashamed in proclaiming the gospel through both creation and the story of the Ark. And that is awesome. And then we got to do a D-Life boot camp, D-Life training in Somerset, Kentucky, yesterday morning. It was incredible. A little church with a huge crowd for the D-Life training, and more people around the world are joining in the disciple-making movement, and people are beginning to catch on that discipleship is not a program, it's a lifestyle that we lived, and more people are joining that lifestyle. So we give glory to God. Well, today begins our week of prayer, and I hope that you'll go and get a prayer guide, and let's use it all week, and every day. What we're asking of you is that every day, whether it's at morning or night, whenever you have time to get alone, get in a closet, get in a room by yourself, and spend some unbroken time with God, maybe 30 minutes, maybe an hour, use the prayer guide. We'll have a devotional video every day, and when you're ready to pray, you can watch the Devo that will give you a little info about the Passion Week and what Jesus was doing in the Passion Week, and kind of set up the prayer, and then the prayer guide is something that you can use. We, as a nation and as a world, we need revival. We need it so desperately. We need for God to move. I think every one of us in this room would agree with that. We know that, and we need to pray for God to move. I would love it if this Easter, if this Easter, this coming Sunday, people that have been away from church for maybe a while with the pandemic would come back in droves, and that people's heart would be open to God, that people that haven't been in church in a long time would come, and that we would see God begin to move on Easter Sunday. And let's pray for that right here at North Park. We're going to have four services. Remember, we've got the Saturday service at 5, and then our regular 3 services on Sunday morning. We'll be able to have room for people. Invite your guests, invite your neighbors, bring them with you next Sunday for a great day of worship here at North Park. I'm really looking forward to it. And then we've got that Friday night, Good Friday service, that will kind of be the climax of our week of prayer. And we'll have communion here. That's going to be a family service. Bring your kids. It'll be a short service, but we'll share communion together and praise. So join us at 6 o'clock on Friday. Well, if you have your Bible this morning, I hope that you do, open them with me to Exodus 15, verse 22 through 27. And while you're turning there in your Bible, let me just say to all of you who may be new to our church that right after this service, we have a reception called Meet the Pastor. And I would love to meet you. I'll be out these doors, and just before you go out the exit doors, I'll be there at the right. And I would love for you to stop by for just a second. Let me meet you personally. I have a gift from our church I'd love to give you, and that'd be a great joy if you would take a second. Let me meet you. Also, if you've been coming and you feel like the Lord is leading you to join our North Park family, you could come to meet the pastor, and I would love to talk to you about being a member of our church as well. Well, this morning, I want to share with you about the joy in the journey. Several years ago, there was a contemporary Christian artist that was named Michael Card, and he had a song that I loved. It really ministered to me and Rondi as well. And the song was called Joy in the Journey. And the song went like this: there is a joy in the journey. There's a light that we can love on the way. There is a wonder and wildness to life and freedom for those who obey. And the song that says there's a joy to the journey is something that I cherish, because for me, there's been a lot of joy in the journey of life. There's a lot of joy in this journey. Now, as we are, as a church, reading the book of Exodus, we're reading through the Old Testament together, the stories of the Old Testament, reading the book of Exodus, let me just kind of help you frame something in your mind. The story of the Israelites and their freedom from Egypt and their journey toward the promised land is a parallel of life. And as you read it, it's important that you kind of get that in your mind. The Passover, from the Passover lamb to the promised land, is parallel and a picture of our salvation. We are saved by grace through faith in the blood of our lamb, the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ. And the Passover lamb that was applied to the doorpost of the Israelites when they were in Egypt, and the death angel passed over those that had the blood of the lamb over their door, that was what brought about their salvation, brought about their freedom, their deliverance from bondage, from slavery in Egypt. And God promised them a land, the promised land. He said, I'm going to give you the promised land. And so that's the same with us, right? We have been saved by grace through faith in Jesus who died for us. And when we are saved, immediately we have the promise of eternal life. We live with that every day. We know that if we die, we're going to be in heaven. But now, as we read through Exodus and even through Numbers, the journey through the wilderness is a parallel of our life on earth. It's a picture of our life on earth. And there are some people who are believers who think that when we're saved, that we're immediately in the promised land. And that when we're saved, there's never going to be any trouble, no problems, no trials, no bitter experiences, because we're saved and we have the promised land. But what we don't realize is we're not in the promised land yet. You and I have the assurance and the guarantee as believers we're going to be in the promised land, heaven, but we're not there yet. We are in our journey through the wilderness, and God is with us, but this life is our journey through the wilderness. It's so important that we understand that. We might ask the question as we read the book of Exodus, is why did God not deliver them from Egypt and just immediately they're in the promised land? Why weren't they just immediately there? Why did they have to go through those years of being in the wilderness? And God ordained that by His sovereignty. He wanted them to learn about who He was. He wanted them to experience faith and the journey of faith. And the same is true with us. Let me ask you this question. I want you to think about it. If you knew, what if it was like this? What if when you were saved and baptized, you immediately went to heaven? The moment you were saved, whether you were saved at the age of 9 or at the age of 90, what if the moment you were saved and right after you were baptized, you went to heaven and you experienced this life no more? Would you welcome that? Would you want that? Is that something that you would desire? Or would you say, well, I kind of enjoy this life. There's a lot that I'm learning about God, and this is part of the experience that's getting me ready for heaven. I don't know what you would choose. Maybe you would say, yeah, if I could go immediately to heaven. But I think for many of us in this room, we would say, well, you know, I like this experience. I think this is an important part of my journey to heaven. And I think God thinks that way too, obviously, right? Because we're here. God has a reason for us to go through life. And what I want you to realize with me today is because of our faith in the Lord through Jesus Christ, even though this life will bring with it its trials and its tribulations, just like we saw last week, right? I mean, this life brings tornadoes. This life brings difficult times. And just because you're a Christian don't mean your home was safe from that tornado. It doesn't mean that. There were godly people's homes that were destroyed, just like there were people that don't believe in God's homes that were destroyed. This journey through life can have bitter experiences. But even though this journey can have bitter experiences, what I want you to see with me this morning is that there can be a joy in this journey. There can be joy in this journey. The Israelites had experienced deliverance from Egypt. They had just experienced a miracle by going through the Red Sea on dry land. God parted the Red Sea. They go through the Red Sea on dry land. The Egyptian army is destroyed as God closed the Red Sea over them. And in chapter 15, almost the whole chapter is a song of celebration, right? It's the song of Moses. It's the song of Miriam. They are praising. They are worshiping. They've experienced triumph. 3 days later, 3 days, they find themselves in Marah. Marah means bitterness. And their triumph is turned to grumbling. Look at it. In our text today, the Bible says the Israelites' song of triumph by the Red Sea were turned into cries of murmuring by the waters of Marah. So here's the main idea I want to share with you. I want you to see with me. The key to joy in the journey is to stay focused on Jesus. That's the key to the joy of the journey. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Would you stand with me to honor the reading of God's Word? And let's read it together in Genesis chapter 15, verses 22 through 27. And let's pick up actually with verse 21, because this is the last part of their song of praise. It says that Miriam sang to them, "Sing to the Lord, for He has triumphed gloriously. The horse and the rider He has thrown into the sea." Then Moses made Israel set out from the Red Sea, and they went into the wilderness of Shur. They went 3 days in the wilderness, and they found no water. And when they came to Marah, they could not drink the water of Marah because it was bitter. Therefore it was named Marah, which means bitter. And the people grumbled against Moses, saying, "What shall we drink?" And he cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree. And he threw it into the water, and the water became sweet. Then the Lord made for them a statute and a rule, and there he tested them, saying, "I will diligently listen to the voice. If you will diligently listen to the voice of God, and do that which is right in His eyes, and give ear to His commandments, and keep all of His statutes, I will not put on you any of the diseases that I put on the Egyptians, for I am Jehovah Rapha. I am the Lord your healer." Then they came to Elim, where there were 12 springs of water and 70 palm trees, and they encamped there by the water. Our Heavenly Father, we thank You for the journey of life. It's such a joy to know that we are saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. We have the joy of salvation. But God, as we go through the wilderness of life, we are pilgrims here. And there will be bitter experiences. There will be tough times. There will be times of testing. But You are always with us. And You will get us to the promised land. But there can be joy in this journey if we keep our eyes on Jesus. God, teach us about that today. In Jesus' name, amen. And so indeed, the main idea that we want to see today is the key to joy in this journey through life is that we stay focused on Jesus Christ. And there are some things about the Israelites and their journey through the wilderness that I want us to notice this morning. There are some things that we need to know about this journey. Number one is that the journey will have its ups and downs. That's something that we must understand as we go through life, is that this journey, even for a believer, even if you love the Lord with all your heart, even if you're in the center of God's will and you're obeying God, this journey will have its ups and downs. There are going to be times of great triumph, and then there are going to be times of testing. There are going to be times that we go through times that we would refer to as bitter. And we see that here with the Israelites. They had just experienced the triumph of being set free from bondage, 400 years of slavery in Egypt, that God did a great work for them. And then not only that, but they came to the Red Sea and God parted the Red Sea, a great, glorious miracle. They go through the Red Sea on dry land, and then they get on the other side and they worship, they sing, they praise. And then it says in verse 22, then Moses made Israel set out from the Red Sea, and they went into the wilderness of Shur. So now they're entering into the wilderness. And this wilderness is a picture of life here on earth. And they went 3 days into the wilderness, just 3 days, and they found no water. Now I would suggest to you that that was a pretty strong test, because historians, and we would get from reading the Bible, that there was probably 600,000 men that left Egypt. So that could have been well over a million, or maybe somewhere between 1 and 2 million women, men, women, and children that Moses is leading through the wilderness. I mean, I can't fathom that. That's a lot of people that he's trying to lead through a desert. And you could go one day without water, and you'd be all right. You might could go 2 days without water, but you can't really go 3 days in the wilderness without water before you begin to have consequences. And so they were 3 days without water for their wives, their children, their livestock, all the horses, the cattle that they had taken with them out of Egypt. And so, yeah, it was a concern that they had no water. And the Bible says when they came to Marah, they found water. So you could almost imagine when they got to Marah, they were excited and they just started running toward the water. They finally thought they had found hope. And then when they get to the water and start to drink it, they find out that it's not drinkable. It's bitter water. And that's even a greater disappointment, right? Because you think you found water, but the water's not drinkable. And so they could not drink the water of Marah because it was bitter. Therefore, it was named Marah. And so they went from a very high experience with God to now they're at a very low experience with God, or a very low experience in life. And that sometimes is like the journey that we are on. But can we just know this? Can we just say this together? That as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, even when we go through the bitter experiences of life, As children of God, God is with us. He is there. He never leaves us or forsakes us. And we can know, if we apply our faith, that God will get us through. I love that verse in Psalms that says in Psalm 30, verse 5, weeping may tarry for the night, but joy comes in the morning. Yeah, as believers, we may go through times of weeping. We're going to lose loved ones. We're going to have bitter experiences. Weeping may last for a night, but through keeping our eyes on Jesus Christ, we can know that joy comes in the morning. Do you remember the story of Ruth? Ruth is a beautiful story in the Bible. If you've never read the 4 chapters of Ruth, go read it. It's right after the book of Judges, and it is a remarkable story. And it's a story about, it begins telling us about Elimelech and Naomi. They're a married couple living in Bethlehem, the little town of Bethlehem that Jesus was born in. And there was a famine that came and they had to leave. And Elimelech took Naomi and his 2 sons, Mahlon and Chilion, and they go to Moab. And when they get to Moab, they dwell there and there's no famine there, but Naomi's husband, Elimelech, dies. And now she's a widow. And her two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, take women of Moab to be their wives. And then in a very short time, Mahlon and Chilion die. And Naomi, who went out with a husband and two sons, I mean, everything's good, now experiences life that is very bitter. I mean, she is going through an incredible trial of life. Grief, the loss of a husband, life of two children. You can't experience hardly more grief than that. And can I just say, she was a woman of faith? She was a godly woman. She was a woman who loved the Lord. And that is obvious because her daughter-in-law, Ruth, said, I'm not going to leave you because I see that your God is real, because I don't know how you could get through what you're going through if it weren't for your God. And I'm going to turn away from the God of Moab and I want to embrace your God. I'm going to go where you go. I'm going to follow you. Your people's going to be my people. Your God's going to be my God. And so Ruth, when she went back to Bethlehem after she had lost her husband, lost her children, and the famine was over in Bethlehem, she went back to Bethlehem and everybody came to greet her. And they said, this is Ruth. And she said to them, do not call me, or they said, this is Naomi. And she said, do not call me Naomi, but call me Mara. Now that's the same Hebrew word that is used here in Exodus 15 that applies to the water, bitter water. And she says, call me bitter. Don't call me by my name Naomi. Call me the name Mara, which means bitter. For Almighty God has dealt very bitterly with me. I went away full, and the Lord has brought me back empty. And then it says in verse 22, Naomi returned, and Ruth the Moabite, her daughter-in-law, with her, and they came to Bethlehem at the beginning of barley harvest. Now, after and they came to Bethlehem via barley harvest, you know when you read stories in the Bible, sometimes you read things that are foreshadowing of things to come? When you read the phrase, it was the beginning of barley harvest, that was a phrase that applied to the sovereignty of God and the things that were to come. Because even though Naomi had been through a bitter experience, God is about to bring joy in the morning. Because at barley harvest, that was when Ruth began to glean in the fields for wheat, to have food for Naomi, her mother-in-law, and herself. And it was that brought, by the sovereignty of God, her into contact with Boaz. Boaz was a man of God who was a kinsman redeemer. He could marry Ruth, and he could be the one that became a part of their family. It so happened that Boaz was of the lineage of our Lord Jesus Christ. He is the lineage from which our Lord came from. And so Boaz married Ruth, and they had a child, and the child was the great grandfather of David the king. And Ruth, a Moabite, became a part of the lineage of Jesus. And Naomi, who had experienced bitterness, experienced joy that comes in the morning. And beloved, that is what we hold on to as believers. We believe that we have a God who is sovereign, that He is a God that can always be trusted, and that even when we go through the bitter experiences of life, if we keep our eyes on Jesus Christ, we can be certain that joy comes in the morning. I want you to notice a second thing. The journey goes better with prayer and praise. This journey through life, it goes a lot better when we add to it prayer and praise. The Bible says in the very next verse, when the Israelites found the water was bitter, that the people grumbled against Moses, saying, "What shall we drink?" Now, you know, if you've been reading along, as we read through this time of the wilderness, the children of Israel were professionals when it came to grumbling, murmuring, and complaining. They were pros at it. They had it down. I mean, as soon as they experienced anything bitter in life, immediately they turned away from praise and they began to grumble. I mean, three days earlier, they had been worshiping about what God had done at the Red Sea, and now they're murmuring and they're complaining. And then Moses, he began to pray. Instead of griping, he began to cry out and call on the name of the Lord. And what a great example to follow. You see, when we read through Exodus and Numbers, and we read about the children of Israel and how they would turn so quickly away from God, it's easy for us to look at them and point a finger at them, but sometimes we need to look in the mirror. Because is that not sometimes exactly what we do? I mean, God's been good to us, and then the moment something doesn't go right, instead of persevering with prayer and praise, sometimes we turn to grumbling and complaining and turning away from our faith in God. Sometimes we are so much like them. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 6, Paul said, "Do not be anxious about anything, even when you go through those bitter experiences of life, but in everything, pray." Instead of grumbling and complaining, instead of being anxious, pray and praise. Instead of grumbling and complaining, in everything by prayer and thanksgiving, prayer and praise, let your requests be made known to God. And if we do that, here's the promise. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. And that's a great verse. Many of you have read that verse. Some of us have committed it to memory. And the reality is that sometimes that's a lot easier to say than it is to do, right? Sometimes it's easier to quote that verse, but when you're going through Mara, that bitter experience of life, sometimes it's not as easy to pray and praise as it is to grumble and lose our faith. You say, well, hey, that was easy for Paul to say. Well, you know where Paul was when he wrote that verse? He was in prison. That was a book, the book of Philippians, was what we call one of the prison epistles of the Apostle Paul. He was in jail being persecuted because he was a Christian. He was in jail not because he broke the law or did anything wrong. He was in jail because he was a preacher of the gospel. And he did not know what his future held. He didn't know if he was going to get out of jail, if he was going to be martyred, if they were going to keep him there until he died. And yet instead of grumbling and complaining, he's writing a letter, four chapters that talk about joy in the journey. And he says, even when you are anxious, don't worry, but pray and praise God. Is that practical? Is that real? Is that something we can really do? Well, we see it in the life of Peter. In Acts chapter 12, Peter also found himself in prison, not for anything he had done wrong, but because he was preaching the gospel. And an earnest prayer was made for him to God by the church. The church had gathered in a home, and they were praying and praising. And you know the story? An angel came to the jail cell, the chains fell off Peter, the door opened on its own accord, and Peter left the prison cell and went to the prayer meeting, and he joined them. We also see that in the life of the Apostle Paul. In Acts 16, verse 25, Paul and Silas were also in jail. You know why they were in jail? Because they were being persecuted for preaching the gospel. Not only were they in jail, but they had been beaten with rods as grown men, publicly humiliated, tied up, and beaten with cane poles. And don't just read over that and ignore it, because that was excruciatingly painful. And then after they had been beaten with rods, they received no medical care. They were not taken to an emergency center. They were thrown in a dungeon. They had every reason to grumble and complain. God, why? We were doing your work. We were preaching the gospel. We were in the center of your will. God, why did you let this happen to us? Are we going to die here? But no. It says at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them, and suddenly there was a great earthquake so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were open and everyone's bonds was loosed. And that great miracle resulted in the Philippian jailer being saved. And we see the power of prayer and praise. Many of us today have never faced the kind of persecution that many believers around the world face. Many of us have never faced the kind of persecution that Peter and Paul and Silas and many of the early believers faced. But we're living in a day and time that I want you to realize I think we're going to begin to experience it. I think if we live our faith out loud, unashamedly stand for truth, and we preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, many of us are going to get canceled or something worse. And if that happens to you, how are you going to respond? It's going to be bitter. Be a bitter experience of life. Are you going to grumble and complain? Are you going to say, God, why did you let this happen to me? I was being bold. I was standing up for my faith. I was being a witness. And you get persecuted. Are we going to say, God, why? Are we going to praise God that we had the joy of being persecuted for our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ? Are we going to pray and trust Him to get us through? Oh, the power of praise, the power of prayer. So much better than grumbling and complaining. Notice the third thing, the journey requires us to trust and obey. In verse 25, after Moses prayed, the Lord showed him a tree, and he threw it into the water. God said, you know, I want you to throw this tree in the water. And the water that was bitter became sweet. And there the Lord made for them a statute. There he tested them. You see, that tree was there all the time. That tree was there. But when Moses prayed, God said, take that tree and throw it into the water. And when you throw that tree into the water, this bitter water is going to be made sweet. And man, was it ever a powerful miracle, because the water was sweet enough to give to satisfy the thirst of millions of people and all of their livestock and everything else. It was a great miracle. You know, when a skeptic, somebody that doesn't believe the Bible, reads that text, you know what they do? They go start trying to find a tree that will make bitter water sweet. They try to find some biological tree. Oh, what tree could that be? Where could we find a tree that you could throw it in water and make it sweet? Can I tell you, you're never going to find a biological tree like that? Because you know what that tree was? That tree was reminding the Israelites they need to keep their eyes on Jesus. That tree represented the cross of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And when the tree of the cross, you know, this is good, this is the Holy Week. Good Friday is coming. Good Friday is the day that Jesus Christ, volitionally of His own free will, died for your sins on a cross. It was on this day right here, Palm Sunday, that Jesus went into Jerusalem knowing that His destiny was with a cross. And He went anyway. He knew it, and He chose to go because of His love for me and you. And by dying on that cross, our Lord Jesus Christ provided the way for us to be saved. And because of His death and our faith in Him, you and I become children of God. Our sins are forgiven. We are reconciled to God the Father. We have a relationship with God all through the journey of life. He will never leave us or forsake us. We have the promise of the promised land, and He's going to get us there. We will spend eternal life in heaven. He guarantees it. And in that joy of our salvation is what makes all bitter experiences of life sweet. It is the great trump card. No matter what bitter experience I go through on life, Satan or no circumstance can ever take away the wonderful, blessed joy of my salvation. We have the joy of salvation because of the cross of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You see, He's been pointing them to Jesus all through the Old Testament. The ark is huge. The door of that ark was a picture of our Savior Jesus Christ. He said, I am the door. The tree that we see in this text was a beautiful picture of our Savior Jesus Christ. The bread that we read about in the next chapter that came down from heaven is our Lord Jesus Christ, who's the bread of heaven. The water that later would come from the rock was a beautiful picture of our Savior. In Exodus 17:5, again they come to a place where there's no water. And again, they grumble again. And the Lord said to Moses, pass before the people, taking with you some of the elders of Israel, and take your hand the staff, the rod of God, which you struck the Nile, and go. And behold, I will stand before you there on the rock at Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and the water shall come out of it, and people will drink. I mean, God brought water out of a rock. When Moses struck the rock, God brought enough water out of a rock to give water to over 1 million people. And that rock is Jesus. It says in 1 Corinthians 10:4, and all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them, and the rock was Jesus Christ. Oh, the difference that He makes in our life. 1 Peter 2:24 says, He Himself bore our sins in His body on the tree. He bore our sins on that tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By His wounds, hallelujah, you have been healed. The last thing is, the journey can lead to grace upon grace. This journey that we go through in life, we're not in heaven yet, but you know what we have? We have grace upon grace upon grace upon grace. And you see it right here in the story. He said, if you will listen to me and obey my voice, if you will listen and do what is right in my eyes, I will not put any of these things on you. If you will give ear to my commandments and statutes, I will put none of these diseases on you that I put on the Egyptians. For I am the Lord your healer. When He says, I am the Lord your healer, He's revealing a new name. He's revealing something new about Himself. That is the name Jehovah Rapha. I am the God that healeth you. Then they came after Marah to Elam, where there were 12 springs of water, abundant water, and 70 palm trees, and they encamped there by the river. Jehovah Rapha, the Lord our healer, was the God that they met at Marah. Did you realize we don't find God revealing Himself by a new name at Elam, but at Marah? It's in those bitter experiences of life that we find that God is there all the time. We may not recognize Him, but He's there. And He's providing grace upon grace. In John 1:16, Jesus said, for from His fullness we have all received grace upon grace. You and I have experienced the grace of salvation. Ephesians 2:8, for by grace you have been saved through faith, that this not of your own doing. It's a gift of God. Salvation is not by our works, but it's a gift of God that comes through faith because of His grace. It is not the result of works, that no one should boast. We are saved by grace. We begin this journey through the wilderness by grace. But then all along the way, there's grace, even in the bitter experiences of life. In 2 Corinthians 12:9, Paul had a bitter thorn in the flesh. We don't know exactly what it was, but it was painful. And he asked God 3 times to take it away, and God said no. But instead of taking your thorn away, I'm going to give you grace upon grace. The Bible says, but He said to me, by my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in your weakness. And God provided grace through that experience of life. James Montgomery Boyce, in his book, The Life of Moses, said the Israelites first learned that God is Jehovah, the great I Am, the powerful God who conquered the Egyptians and brought them out of Egypt. But it was in the wilderness that they learned that their powerful delivering God is also the God of healing, the God who will take care of them each step of the way through the wilderness. Praise God. The key to joy in the journey is to stay focused on Jesus every step of the way. Will you turn your eyes upon Jesus? If you're here today and maybe life has brought on you a hard experience right now, you're going through a tough time, it's challenged you, it's tested you, this was meant for you. God wanted this message for you. Right now, the most important thing you can do is turn your eyes on Jesus and trust in His marvelous grace. Will you trust in the cross of Jesus? If you're here this morning, you've never been saved, you've never given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, you've never known the joy of salvation, you could today. He died for you on a cross so that you could have salvation and joy. My prayer would be that you would trust Him today. Would you bow with me? Could we pray together? Let's pray together. Father, there are some here today that, God, that they're going through a tough time. Lord, they're going through Mara. It's a tough experience in their life. It's a test of our faith. And, oh God, I pray right now Your Holy Spirit would just give them grace. Lord, would they just feel the power of Your grace flow through them at this very moment? And know that You're there, that You have not left them, that You've not abandoned them, that You're Jehovah Rapha, that You're the God that heals, that You're the God that provides. And I pray, God, that instead of losing their faith, that You would just replace it with joy. And that they would pray and praise their way through this. That they would trust and obey. And oh God, I pray that You would provide grace upon grace. And Father, for that one here today or that one watching online who's never trusted the Lord as their Savior, they're lost, living without hope. God, I pray that today would be the day that You draw them to Jesus. I pray that today would be the day of salvation. I pray that today would be the day they turn and put their faith in Your marvelous grace, the grace that took Jesus to the cross to die for their sin. And if that's you, if you're here or you're watching and today you want to be saved, today you want to receive forgiveness and have a relationship with God, would you pray this prayer with me right there in your heart? Dear Jesus, I need You. Thank You so much that You went to the cross for me. Thank You that You bore my sin on that tree so that I could be forgiven of all my sin and I could be saved and I could have the promise of eternal life in heaven. Forgive me that I have lived a life without You. Forgive me for my sin. I ask You to take that away today, and I take Jesus to be my Lord and Savior. I take Him into my life. I put my trust in Him. Lord, please forgive me and help me to live for You for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Oh, if you prayed that prayer, this is the greatest Palm Sunday of your life. You've just been saved. You're going to know the Easter experience like you've never known it before. And I want you to let me know that you prayed that prayer. If you prayed that prayer here, I'm going to be right outside these doors at Meet the Pastor. Come there right now after the service. Let me know. If you're watching online and you prayed that prayer, send me an email. Send me a text right now. If you're going through a bitter experience of life and you just need God's grace upon grace, this altar is open. I invite you to come right now and just kneel and pray. And instead of grumbling and complaining, right now, come to this altar and let there be prayer and praise in your life today. Let's stand and let's worship our Lord.
Oh God, we thank You for the cross and we continue to worship You, Lord. Oh, we honor You with our voices. We honor You with our life, God. Oh, we sing to You. I would be hopeless without Your goodness. I would be desperate without Your love. Slave to the dark. If it wasn't for the cross, would you sing with me? You have wired me with Your kindness. Chase me down when I was lost. Where would I be if it was? We'll be right back. God, we go forth from this place. I pray that we will keep our eyes fixed on Jesus Christ. Fixed on you, Lord. And the distractions that will come our way, I pray that we will push those aside. And we'll turn away from those. And we'll fix our eyes on Christ. So we go forth from this place with the power of the Lord in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, thank you so much for coming. We want to dismiss now in somewhat of an organized way. We're going to let those in the balcony exit first and those of you on the lower stadium seating. God bless you, and I'll see you next time. Easter prayer this week. God bless you. Thank you so much. Everybody else, hold on just a second.